Thank you very much. You're very kind, Mr. Chairman. Thanks to Ms. Gabbard and the other members of the subcommittee for the opportunity to testify today on these important issues. Before I begin, I'd respectfully request that you accept my written testimony for the record. I'd also like to take the opportunity to thank the chairman for his leadership on the issue and his work to enhance our engagement with the Asia-Pacific region. The members of this subcommittee know full well the importance of our interests in the Asia-Pacific region. As Secretary Kerry has made very, very clear, at the core of our strategic rebalancing is a determination to ensure that the Asia-Pacific region remains open, inclusive, and prosperous, and that it's guided by accepted rules and standards and respect for international law. Through our alliances, through our partnerships, the U.S. has been instrumental in sustaining a maritime regime based on international law that has allowed the countries in the region to prosper. And as a maritime nation with global trading networks, the U.S. has a national interest in the maintenance of peace and stability, respect for international law, unimpeded lawful commerce, and freedom of navigation and overflight, including and especially in the East China Sea and the South China Sea areas. For these reasons, the behavior and the tensions between the claimants are of deep concern to us and to our allies. An incident in these waters could touch off an escalatory cycle which would have very serious adverse effects on our economic and our security interests. That's why the Obama administration has consistently emphasized the importance of exercising restraint, of maintaining open channels of dialogue, of lowering rhetoric, of behaving safely and responsibly both in the sky and the sea, and peacefully resolving territorial and maritime disputes in keeping with international law. We oppose and we have sought to prevent unilateral actions that disrupt the status quo or jeopardize that peace and security. In the South China Sea, we have supported efforts by ASEAN and China to reach agreement on an effective code of conduct, which is long overdue, in order to promote a rules-based framework for managing and regulating the behavior of the countries. And in the East China Sea, we remain concerned about the serious downturn in Sino-Japanese relations. It is important to lower tensions, to turn down the rhetoric, and to exercise caution and restraint in this sensitive area. However, China's announcement of an air defense identification zone, an ADIZ, in the East China Sea in late November was a step in the wrong direction. We neither recognize nor accept China's declared ADIZ. The United States has no intention of changing how we conduct our operations in the region. And we've made clear to China that it shouldn't attempt to implement that ADIZ and should refrain from taking similar actions elsewhere in the region. Mr. Chairman, as I mentioned at the outset, the U.S. has a deep and longstanding stake in the maintenance of prosperity and stability in the Asia-Pacific, and an equally deep and abiding long-term interest in the continued freedom of the seas based on the rule of law, rule that guarantees, among other things, freedom of navigation, freedom of overflight, and the other internationally lawful uses of the sea. International law also makes clear the legal basis on which states can legitimately assert their rights in the maritime domain or can exploit maritime resources. So the United States takes the strong position that maritime claims must accord with customary international law. Even though the United States isn't a claimant, and even though the United States takes no position on the competing claims to sovereignty over disputed land features in the East China Sea or the South China Sea, we believe strongly, as I said, that the claims must accord with international law. We also care deeply that all countries deal with their territorial and their maritime disputes peacefully, diplomatically, and in accordance with international law. This means ensuring that claimants manage their differences without intimidation, coercion, or the use of force. We are candid with claimants, all the claimants, when we have concerns regarding their claims or the behavior in the way that they pursue them. Deputy Secretary Bill Burns and I were in Beijing last month and held extensive discussions with Chinese officials, for example. In these discussions, we directly raised our concerns about what we see as a growing incremental pattern of efforts by China to assert control over the area contained in the so-called nine-dash line in the South China Sea. Among other steps, this includes continued restrictions on access to the Scarborough Reef, pressure on the longstanding Philippine presence at the Second Thomas Shoal, and the recent updating of fishing regulations covering disputed areas in the South China Sea. Our view is that these actions have raised tensions in the region and have exacerbated concerns about China's long-term strategic objectives. China's lack of clarity with regard to its South China Sea claims have created uncertainty in the region and limit the prospect for achieving mutually agreeable resolution or equitable joint development arrangements. At the risk of repeating myself, I want to reinforce the point, Mr. Chairman, that under international law, maritime claims in the South China Sea must be derived from land features, and any Chinese claim to maritime rights not based on claimed land features would be inconsistent with international law. China could highlight its respect for international law by clarifying or adjusting its claim to bring it into accordance with international law of the sea. Along with that, we strongly support serious and sustained bilateral as well as multilateral dialogue among claimants to address and manage overlapping claims in a peaceful and non-coercive way. We support the rights of the claimants themselves to avail themselves of peaceful dispute mechanisms. The Philippines itself chose to exercise such a right last year with the filing of an arbitration case under the law of the sea. Now, these legal and diplomatic processes will take time, but the relevant parties in the near term can take steps to lower tension and avoid escalation. That includes practical mechanisms to prevent incidents or manage them when they occur. Another would be for the claimants to agree not to undertake new unilateral steps to change the status quo. In the meantime, the U.S. is committed to promoting regional stability through continued strong diplomatic and military presence. This includes our efforts to promote best practices and good cooperation on all aspects of maritime security and to bolster maritime domain awareness, including through our capacity-building programs throughout Southeast Asia. It includes strengthening institutions like ASEAN and the East Asia Summit as regional venues where countries can engage in dialogue with all involved, both about the principles but also about practical measures to avoid conflict. This is an issue of immense importance to the United States, to the Asia Pacific, and to the world, and I want to reaffirm here today that the United States will continue to play the central role in underwriting security and stability in the Asia Pacific that has guaranteed peace and facilitated prosperity for the last six plus decades. Mr. Chairman, I thank you very much for the opportunity to appear here today, and I look forward to hearing further views from the members of the committee and to answering any questions that you have. Thank you.